There's one thing that you don't need is another child born in ghetto. Oh, people, don't you understand? Child needs a helping hand. He's gonna be an angry old man someday. Take a look at you and me. We're too fly to see. Should be turning. Look the other way. Where the world turned. Where the world turned. Funny looking girl with a funny nose. Plays in the streets with the good time blows. In the ghetto. In the ghetto. People, don't you understand? Elvis is a white man. He wants to come back soon, so be ready. He's a crazy man. He's a funny man. Please don't forget the king. He's alive and wants to come back to hello.
Hi, I'm Robert DeValle Jr. I just want to prove to the world that Elvis is alive, still with us, breathing. Faked his death because the Black Panthers were after him and his family. In order to save his daughter and his life and his family, the dad's life, he had to fake his death August 16th, 1977. Been trying to come back since 2012. We can make this happen by joining Margarita 29 YouTube channel and signing the petition on our videos. This is not a joke. This is real and it's going to happen with or without your help. Thank you.
see you riding. Oh, see what you have done.
I'm gonna stay right. Really? Because it looks like Casey's teaching you how to kiss out of pity.
Oh, well, honey, show me. Yes.
Okay.
This is getting better. It's getting better.
Okay.
This is getting better. It's getting better.
Okay.
Elvis, there's a story I have to tell to the world that's never been told before. Elvis, one rainy, hot summer night here in Nashville about 7 or 8 years ago, what you did for me will always be a part of my life forever, as you will be for millions. You see, I was sitting on the back steps of RCA's Studio B that hot summer night, I guess trying to get out of the rain, not knowing it was you inside the studio recording. When some man opened the door and I stood up, and he asked me if I would go after some candy bars. I guess maybe he thought I worked there as a cleanup boy or something, but I really didn't. When I got back to the studio door, the candy bars in the paper bag was wet, and so was I. You see, I hadn't had a car for about 6 years. I knocked on the door, and the same man let me in. Then I heard a voice ask that I bring the candy bars into the studio. When I saw it was you that I got the candy bars for, I became very weak all over. I guess it was too much for a poor boy and a nobody like me to be bringing candy bars to a king like you. I remember you asked me my name and shook my hand and thanked me. And then you reached in your pocket and gave me a $20 bill and said, "Here, I want you to have this." You never did know it, Elvis, but that $20 bill, I guess in a big way, saved my life. You see, I'd been sleeping in the back of an old wrecked station wagon, just up from the studio, for about 11 days, with only change in my pocket. And to be honest, I really hadn't eaten for almost 2 days. I never did see you again after that, but I want the whole world to know, if they don't already, the many little and big things you did for many people, such as myself. Elvis, I only wish I could have the chance again today to run to that same little store in the rain to get you some more candy.
tamer than you were, I think. You had a more wild image. Am I correct in thinking that?
Well, I think Elvis was a little bit more conservative than I was. He hid himself more, I would say, from the public than I did. I was more wide open than Elvis. I never hid anything. Yeah. Whatever I did, I never tried to hold it a secret.
There's one story that is, I read constantly about you, that you went to Graceland, you had a gun, the sheriff comes, takes you away. What is the truth behind that story, if there is any, but what happened?
Elvis, in the last days there, he was, about 15 times he called me on the phone, you know, and he said, "Jerry, I got to see you, it's very important, I'm very depressed and I want to talk to you, you know, and he'd talk to you bad." I just couldn't visualize Elvis Presley being down and out, depressed about anything. I shunned him off and I didn't go, you know. And one night he called me down at the Vapors Club there in Memphis, about a mile or so from his home. And it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. And to admit the truth about it, I was drinking a lot of champagne that night. I don't drink champagne. And it made me a little wild, you know.
A little bit.
And so, yeah, really. Yeah. And so, to say the least. So I went out and got my Lincoln car, you know. I said, "Well, I'm going to come down and see you, so I'll be there in a minute," you know. So I walked outside, and Mr. Ford, Charlie Ford, was on the Vapors. He said, "Jerry, just a minute, I have a present for you." And he gave me this .38 Dillinger pistol. It was brand new. Had never been fired. I still have it. Never has been fired. And I said, "Oh, thank you, Mr. Ford." And I went to put it in my glove compartment. He said, "No, put this on the dashboard. If you conceal it in your glove compartment, it's against the law, run you down, it's against the law. But if you put it on your dashboard and not conceal it, it's not against the law. Take it home." I said, "Okay, well, I forgot I was going by Elvis's house."
So you drove by with the gun out.
So I drove by there, and the gun was there on the dashboard. Yeah. And when I turned into Elvis's house, it was the front end of that Lincoln, like it was a mile long to me. And I misjudged it, and I ran into his gate. And he had hired a new guard. Travis wasn't on the gate. He had a new guard on the gate. So he come running out there, and I hit the gate, and it was shaking all over like he was doing a show on there, you know? And it was kind of funny to me, I don't know. And he said, "Well, what do you want?" I said, "Well, Elvis called me and wants to see me." He said, "Yeah, who are you?" I said, "Well, just tell him Jerry Lee's here, you know." And he saw that gun on the day of the corner of the car. And he ran back and he called the law. And so I'm sitting there, you know, and a minute later, the law about 5 or 6 squad cars surrounded my car, you know. I'm sitting there looking at it, and I was really loaded. And I went to put the seat back on the car, and instead of putting the seat back, I was putting the window down. And I didn't know it. I threw this champagne bottle out the window, and I thought it was down and knocked the whole window clean out. So they knew I was loaded. And it was embarrassing. And I said, "What are you going to do with that gun? You going to shoot it up as president?" I said, "Well, if you're silly enough to think that," I said, "probably so."
And that's where it came.
And he said, "Get out of that car, though, okay." That was the deal on that. And Elvis waited on me.
Was there ever any competition between the two of you? Did you ever feel that? I mean, you're both,
no.
You know, the leaders of a movement, almost a revolution.
We considered ourselves both kings of rock and roll, so to speak, coming in our own way. He considered himself the number one artist, I did too. And the honest thing, I'd done what I wanted to do. Elvis, he wanted to do the things I did, but he was scared to. And he tried to do it and hide it. And so I said, "Elvis, you know, you ought to be your own man, do what you want to. Don't let these people tell you what to do." Well, Elvis Presley was a fine person. And I miss him very much. And he was one of my dear friends, somebody I could depend on, you know?
When you talk about, as you saw yourself as kings, you both saw yourself as kings, a question I was wanting to ask you is, when the history of rock and roll is written, where will your place be?
Well, I was the first artist inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Did the launch chair go off?
Yeah. You could see it in the sky when it disconnected up there. Gigi never saw the explosion. I didn't know it.
I had lunch.
Because it just launched right over here.
I had lunch.
I was buried in a beaver.
How was your lunch?
No, no, they don't have sound.
Who do you want to
watch? They don't have sound.
They do?
No.
It's just they don't have sound.
It's just picture.
Oh, is it?
Just picture.
They got sound taped in there, ain't they?
That's why I want to say no. I wanted to know.
Okay.
They believe that's sex now, right there.
Well, you got to do a 5-minute monologue over this.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
5-minute monologue to cover it, man.
What a friend we have in the editor.